Hello, I just wanted to talk about my attempt at switching from VS Code to Neovim for predominantly coding in Rust. If I need to do anything in JavaScript or HTML, then I will switch back to VS Code. However, my main focus is learning more Rust. Rust Analyzer is, once you start using it, is obviously like it's like having your, if you didn't have it, it would be like having your right arm cut off. So my biggest concern was getting Rust Analyzer working with Neovim. So what I did was some background research. I tried some of the easy Vim setups. I think there's nvchad and there's Arch Vim, I think it's called. But they seem like frameworks, and the more that you go into them, the more you have to learn their specific syntax. And also, I was finding that there was a few tutorials which were then leading you down kind of the Lua path to have to learn lots of Lua configuration or lots of editing of configuration files written in Lua. Lua is not particularly difficult to look at, but there's just so much to edit and configure. So by using YCM, you complete me. If you go to GitHub, you can find it. That was what actually made me switch. And then I tried Vundle, which was the plugin manager. Long story short, let me just show you what I've actually got working. So I started this on Saturday. Today is Tuesday. I've come full circle really, because now I'm back to editing and configuring the settings in init.vim, and I'm happy with that. I'm happy because I've got Rust Analyzer working, I've got a theme, Capuchin, which seems to be all the rage these days, and I like it. And I've also got the completions working, which if you look at line 10, I know remap. I've also set relative number, which I'm not even using as I speak, bad person. So the COC was the tricky bit that I had to get working, because on this Linux Mint distro, I was getting errors with PPA releases, so I had to go into the PPA list, etc., something something PPA list, and delete a lot of the PPAs. And ultimately, I got Node.js running or installed with version 18. Once I'd done that, then I could get COC installed. Once I got COC installed, then Rust Analyzer started working. So yeah, if I go nvim, and what was I going to show you? Plug install, and then you can see all I've got is one theme, and I've got coc.nvim, which is what. Then, and you can see the elapsed time. The load times on the VS Code extensions do add up, so it's quite annoying eventually once you keep opening and closing VS Code several times a day, and it takes maybe 1 or 2 seconds. It's surprising how impatient you can get. And right, back to this. So the other thing I wanted to just say was John Jensett gave me the inspiration. I watched one of his videos on the weekend, and that's what kind of gave me the final encouragement. So if you've not seen his videos, he worked for Amazon, and he was in charge of Rust at Amazon. I say in charge. I can't remember his official job title, but having watched his videos, he definitely knows his, I don't know if I'm allowed to say the word, he knows his stuff. And he's using Vim, Neovim, so if it's good enough for him. And that kind of made me think, well, Rust Analyzer obviously works fine with it. And really, I think if you've only ever used VS Code, you think, oh wow, it's got all these features, I don't want to go to something like a text editor. But actually, VS Code uses a lot of the features, same features, to make itself look good. So those very same features aren't part of VS Code. The part of code like Rust Analyzer is something completely, independent of VS Code. But because VS Code uses it, you think, oh, wow, this is amazing. But if you just go back a step, you actually find out the Rust Analyzer is not specific to VS Code. And so many of you probably already knew that, but it was kind of, I probably hadn't thought about some of these things quite hard enough. And I'm not getting any kickback off this, really, but I'm quite pleased with this book. I think it cost me that price when I bought it at the start of the year. And I don't own many books, partly because of space and partly because of cost and so on. But typically when I start a new language, I'll buy one big thick book. And this was the one that I bought, and I'm very happy with it. I've looked at a couple of others via Kindle, PDF and so on. And I still think this is probably the best one on balance. And even today, I've been just running through some examples. Let's open this up. And source. And even today, what I've been trying to do is, I did a video a while back on my other channel, Python channel, and it was about spaced repetition and the Feynman technique. And so I'm not showing off or anything, far from it. My memory's not great, and I've been trying to read about how to improve it or use other techniques, not so much improving your memory, but how to make the most of it or optimize it. So memory palaces, or nothing new there, but it's just a good technique to visualize things. And then once you visualize something, it becomes easier to remember because you have those kind of pictures in your head. And what you do is you visualize an item in each room, and that item corresponds to the thing that you're trying to remember. And make it as absurd or outrageous as you can, because that makes it more memorable. Trying to apply it to code is actually quite difficult, because if somebody tries to says, oh, well, memorize, use standard num pass int error. Trying to make an image for that is not actually, I would probably have to think of something like parsley. I don't know. Parsley. International used to make tractors, so I would remember that via a red tractor. Parsley. So parsley on a red tractor, accidentally driving into, I don't know, but there you go. They just make it more outrageous, and then ultimately you'll remember it. So I've been typing this from memory, and I've been using Rust Analyzer just kicks in. So it's I'm liking it a lot. And let A equals 5. The only thing I'm slightly, I probably do want ultimately to turn off these, you see here the types. It's just extra clutter on, or extra writing on the screen. Being kind of less is more type of person, I don't really want to see that. Admittedly, it's can be helpful, but yeah, I might turn that off. That's Neovim, and that's taken me since Saturday on and off, kind of thinking, oh, I'll give up. I should be just learning code, and then I'll come back to it. And so there we go. That's my kind of little quick tour of, I'll just show you my config file. And if you go to my GitHub page, RGGH, GitHub, RGGH, whatever, I've added it on there. So, if you do want to just copy my, I'll put it on as a gist. So I think I made it public. So there you go. Call plugin, or call plug hashtag begin, call plug hashtag end. There you go. And I just added, so that's, all you really do is just call Neo CLIDE. That's what you need to make the Rust Analyzer work, I believe. To be honest, I've tried so many things and installed and uninstalled so many things, I may have lost track of what I installed. But basically, rather, Lua was actually just becoming hard work. So you've got multiple choice options when you are trying to create a Vim startup config. So this is where I've arrived at. I'm happy with it. And to be honest, I'm not planning on doing too many more modifications. So I'm going to try and keep it minimal, especially because my laptop's probably 5 or 6 years old. And who knows, one day it might just randomly break on me. So I'm happy with his configs. And if I had to set this up again, I probably could. In rather than 4 days, I could probably do it in about an hour next time. Allowing for forgetfulness and then, you know, possible version changes and so on. So, yeah, and the version, if you install Vim using sudo apt-get on Linux Mint, you get version 7, I believe. So, yeah, you will have to upgrade, or you can compile it from source. I think I did that at one point, but then I probably came back and got a compiled binary also. I can't remember. But, yeah, you need to get 9 or newer, really, I think. Or at least version 8. And I think Linux Mint just gets you version 7. So just be aware of that. So, yeah, give it a try. Don't obviously, if you've got the time. And you might even be tied in with VS Code, particularly if you're running on WSL or on Windows or whatever. But yeah, if you're on a Mac or on Linux, then yeah, give that Neovim a try. I'd always shied away from it, really, because I don't know. It's almost like there's a lot of hype about it almost with nothing against him. I quite like him. amuses me. What's Primogen? Primogen. But sometimes I just think it's all a bit of, there's so much hype about Neovim, but really, once you arrive at a nice screen like this, to me this is nice, I think this is amazing. And once you arrive at something like this with no clutter, and if you accidentally move your mouse, you're not going to accidentally come back and type something and find that you've accidentally removed a line of code or whatever. So yeah, that's it for now. I'm rambling. But thanks for watching, and I'll be back soon with some code.